I'm sorry we're meeting in this type of setting. I've preached to an empty church before. In fact, I do it almost every Sunday. But I come down early and I preach to empty pews to practice my sermon. But this is the first time we've done it this way. And I'm happy that you're with us online, and I hope that you get a blessing out of today. Feel free to share this page right now with your friends and so other people can get on. And we're just going to trust that God gives us a time of blessing today. I want to start the service out with a quick word of prayer and then a song. Let's just have a word of prayer together. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for your presence with us today. Father, it doesn't matter whether we're in church, within the walls of a building, or whether we're at our homes and meeting through this medium or whatever, we are still the church. And Father, I just thank you that we can be the church wherever we are, and that you can bless it and that you can work through it. So Father, as we gather today in this manner, I just pray that you're going to bless our service together, and we pray, Father, that you are glorified through it. Be with all those across our nation that are struggling with the virus. Be with all those across our nation that are struggling, Father, with their jobs being interrupted, their businesses being hurt. Father, we just pray that you will be with them, strengthen them, help them, bless them. And Father, we just pray for your relief. And Father, we especially pray for our leaders right now that are trying so hard to lead our state, our local communities, our states, and our nation through this time of confusion and illness. Father, we just place this in your hands. We pray, Lord, that in the end you are glorified and the church is strengthened. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to play a song for you that I hope will be an encouragement to you. It's called Agnus Dei, and I just pray that it'll be a blessing to you this morning. Take a watch.
Oh, my Lord God. out to Him. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy.
I hope you enjoyed that. You know, God is worthy of our praise. He deserves our attention. He deserves our praise. He deserves us to come before Him, whether we're sitting at home or whether we're sitting here in a sanctuary. God is deserving of our praise. And we just wanted to start out by giving Him praise. I know right now is a frightening time for a lot of people. And we just want to be sure that they remember that God is in control. God has got this, and He's got us, and we're sheltered in the hollow of His hand, and we can trust Him through this situation. Again, if you're watching this on Facebook, go ahead and hit share, and that'll help other people come in and find the service. We have a few announcements that I want to take time to go over with you. The first one comes from from Sandy Glasscock, and she's with our Sandy is our with our county health department, and she's going to be putting these up each day. You're going to be able to hear them on WLD. You're going to be able to see them on the Grand County Press website and the Grand County Press Facebook page. So you can check these each day for updates on what's happening with the virus. You know, she just is reminding people that obviously what we are doing is working to continue to make great progress in the community to help prevent the spread of this disease, but we need everybody's support, and she keeps reiterating that to me over and over again. We need everybody's support. All of our frontline healthcare workers, from EMS to doctor's offices, to health department, to hospitals, even law enforcement, they're working very hard to keep everybody safe, but they need your help too. And so they're asking, please stay at home if you don't need to come out, and practice good social distancing. This is what's helping to keep our number down. If you look, our numbers are very low in West Virginia, where in other states it's skyrocketing. So it's helping to stay at home. It's helping to stay away. Do that as much as possible and try to keep 6 feet away from people. I know that's not always possible, but try. Wash your hands frequently, especially after touching any surface. And one of the surfaces that they're recommending that you be sure to wash after is after you pump gas in your car. That's one you might not have thought about. If you have a fever, cough, shortness of breath, and have traveled somewhere with a reported COVID-19 infection within the last 14 days, please don't leave your home. Call Grant Memorial Hospital, and you have the number there. Press 5 to speak to an ER nurse, and they will see about getting you tested. Grant Memorial Hospital has tested for the Tri-County area, and today, no positive cases. Praise God. We're so thankful for that. There's a few in the county surrounding us. You see that. To get up-to-date information, as I already said, you can go to cdc.gov, or you can go to get this report each day. Go to the Grant County Press website, listen to WELD, go to Grant County Press Facebook page, and we'll keep posting these. They'll keep posting these up there. Next, we want to talk about something that's going to be brand new, an online Bible study that we're doing. On Wednesday evening, we're going to be offering an online Bible study to anyone who would like to participate. This is going to be an interactive online classroom platform where you'll be able to make comments, see others in the study, and participate, not just listen. If interested in participating, contact me by messaging me on Instant Messenger or calling me there. My phone number is listed, or sending an email to my email address that's listed there on the screen. You'll have to download a free program. We're going to be doing it in Zoom, so you have to download Zoom. And then you'll have to get a code from me to join. Now, you're going to need, if you want people to see you and you want people to be able to hear you, you're going to need a webcam hooked to your computer, and you're going to need a mic hooked to your computer. Most newer laptops already have that built in. And so if you're using a newer laptop, you'll see where it's got a little camera at the top and it's got a little mic built into it, and so you wouldn't need anything. Otherwise, you would need to rig that up for your desktop or something like that. Next is, again, something new. We're talking about tithes and offerings. This is for people from the Break Church of the Brethren. This isn't something I'm putting out there to everybody else. But some of you have been asking how you can give your tithes and offerings when we're not having church. This is not a plea for money, okay? This is not what we're trying to do, but this is in response to people asking, how can we still give our tithes? If you want to give, there's two ways. Obviously, you can mail your gift, and the address is there on your screen, P.O. Box 831, Petersburg. Or you can go to the webpage at breakcob.com. And at the top of the page, there's a link you can click on, or there's a button you can click on to make a contribution to the church, to make your tithes or donations to the church using your credit card, debit card, or PayPal. And so you're welcome to give in those ways. Again, this is not a plea for money, but people have been asking how they can continue to give their tithes and offerings to the church, and so this is something we've set up. I want you to remember those that are in need. I want to take a minute to talk about the next thing. If there's any sick or elderly in the Grant County area that are in need of help to get groceries or medication, there's a number of people that have contacted me saying they're willing to help. And so please call Christy Ault, and there's her number, 257-2433, or you can call me, and there's my number, 668-1731. And we'll arrange for somebody to go to the store to buy your groceries for you and bring them back, and you can repay them then when they bring them back. Or if you need medication picked up, they can go to the drugstore and pick it up and bring it to you. Some of the drugstores are delivering, so you can take care of a lot of your medication that way. But anyhow, I just want to let you know that there are people out there willing to help, and if you're in need of that help, excuse me. If you're in need of that help, please let us know. Lastly, I want to remind you that there are some changes in the food pantry. The Interfaith Food Pantry in Grant County is still operational for those in need of food. Call Edna Mullenix at Community Action to receive a food voucher. Do not go to Edna's office, as she's not seeing people right now. Just call the number listed there, 257-1107, and she'll give you time. She'll talk to you on the phone. She'll give you the time you need to go to the pantry. She'll give you the time that you need to show up at the pantry. And when you get to the pantry, don't leave your car. A volunteer will come out and verify that you have a voucher, that they have a voucher for you, and they'll bring the food to your car. Also, the mobile food pantry that was scheduled for April the 4th that we originally put on here, that it had been canceled, has been reinstated, and it will happen. It's going to take place, and this isn't on there, but it's going to take place down at Michael's Field. And again, you'll schedule through Edna Mullenix, and she will put you on a list, and you'll show up at the field. Do not get out of your car. You'll be directed where to go once you get to the field, and they will bring the groceries to your car. So those are the announcements that we have this morning, and we just want to encourage you to be looking around your community and seeing how you might help somebody who's in need. And if we all work together and pray together and seek God together, we're going to get through this thing and we're going to be just fine. I want to share another song with you coming up now. This is one of my favorite songs. The kids at camp love it. It talks about how God just is working in our time right now. The title of the song is Days of Elijah, and it's just an upbeat, happy, powerful song. I hope you enjoy it. Here we go.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining.
Isn't that a great song? I mean, you just can't help but feel good listening to that song. You just can't help but feel blessed. I want to share, and I know, you know, a lot's being said, and you're probably getting tired of hearing people talk about the coronavirus, but I want to talk about it in a different way today. I want to share something with you. I'm titling my message, Seeing Beyond the Coronavirus, and I'm taking a passage from 2 Kings chapter 6, beginning in verse 8 and reading through verse 23, and I want to just share that with you right now. Beginning in verse 8, it says, "Now the king of Abram was at war with the king of Israel. After conferring with his officers, he said, 'I will set up my camp in such and such a place.' The man of God sent word to the king of Israel," the man of God being Elijah, "sent word to the king of Israel, 'Beware of passing that place because the Arameans are going down there.' So the king of Israel checked on the place indicated by the man of God. Time and again, Elijah warned the king so that he was on guard in such places." In other words, Elijah was telling him, "Watch out this place. Your enemy is going to make camp there." And he always was, the king of Israel was always a step ahead because of Elijah. Now verse 11 says, "This enraged the king of Aram, and he summoned his officers and demanded them, 'Will you not tell me which of us is on the side of the king of Israel?' 'None of us, my lord the king,' said one of the officers, 'but Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king the very words which you speak in your bedroom.'" He says it's a prophet of God that's telling him what you're doing. Verse 13, the king says, go and find out where he is, the king ordered, so I can send men and capture him. And the report came back, he is in Dothan. Then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there, and they went by night and surrounded the city. When the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. 'Oh, my Lord, what shall we do?' the servant asked. 'Do not be afraid,' the prophet answered, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them.' And Elijah prayed, 'Lord, open his eyes that he may see.'" And I want you to pay attention to that phrase, "open his eyes that he may see," because that's something we need right now. "Open his eyes that he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots and fire all around Elisha." What a sight. "As the enemy came down towards him, Elisha prayed to the Lord, 'Strike these people with blindness.' So he struck them with blindness as Elijah had asked. And Elisha told them, 'This is not the road and this is not the city. Follow me and I will lead you to the man that you're looking for.' And he led them to Samaria. After they entered the city, Elisha said, 'Lord, open the eyes of these men that they may see.' Then the Lord opened their eyes, and they looked, and behold, they were inside Samaria. When the king of Israel saw them, he asked Elisha, 'Shall I kill them, my father? Shall I kill them?' 'Do not kill them,' he answered. Would you kill men you have captured with your own sword or bow? Set food and water before them, so that they may eat and drink and then go back to the master.' So he prepared a great feast, and after they had finished eating and drinking, he sent them away, and they returned to their master. So the bands from Aram stopped raiding the Israel's territory." Let's just have a word of prayer, can we? Heavenly Father, what an amazing story. A story of how you cared for your people and how you prepared them for what was to come. How you opened the eyes of those that were afraid. The servant who was afraid, let him see that you had this other army surrounded with your army. And then, Father, how you just blinded their eyes that they could be led away to a place of safety. Father, you're an amazing God. I just pray now as we go into this message that you'll open all of our eyes, that we can see you more clearly, that we can understand more clearly what you would have us to understand. And Father, I pray that each one of us would find the courage to look past this virus and this time of crisis and see your hand at work, see you in the clouds. Father, move me aside. I'm not important. What's important is that your message come through right now. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to tell you about a man by the name of Dennis Byrd. He was a professional football player, used to play for the New York Jets. November 29th, 1992, the Jets were playing the Chiefs. Dennis was about to sack the quarterback when he collided with a member of his own team, and in that collision, his spinal cord was snapped. And he was taken off the field, paralyzed. His promising career had come to an end. Everybody figured everything, he was done. He went to the hospital. He woke up in the hospital with one of those halos on his head and unable to move, didn't know where he was, scared to death. He was in the midst of a crisis, didn't know what he was going to do. And he just began to turn to the Lord and say, "Lord, I need your help." People interviewed him. Most people just kind of wrote him off and said, "He's done. He'll never walk again." The doctors told him he probably wouldn't walk again, that he was going to be very limited in what he could do. But he said, "You know, I'm putting myself in the hands of the Lord. And if it's the Lord's will, I'll walk again, and I'll walk again soon." They told him it would be years if he ever regained any ability to walk at all. 1 year from the date of his injury, with 72,000 cheering fans, he walked on to the field, the stadium of the New York Jets football game. People were cheering him. People were ecstatic. He said, "You know, I looked beyond my crisis. I looked beyond what I was dealing with. And I said, 'Lord, I'm placing myself in your hands. I'm trusting you.'" And God honored his faith. And God was glorified in what took place and what happened. Were there times of fear for him? I'm sure there were. I'm sure there were times when he was absolutely terrified, just like Elijah's servant was that day. When Elijah showed, when he showed up and all the armies had surrounded them, Elijah's servant was terrified, just as Dennis was terrified, and just as many people right now are frightened by what's going on with the coronavirus. But Elijah prayed that prayer and said, "God, open their eyes." In other words, he was saying, "God, let my servant look past these soldiers. Let him look past this crisis." And when he did, on the hills surrounding him, there was the army of God with flaming swords ready to protect. Don't you wish right now you could just say, "Oh, God, open my eyes that I can see your presence." And we would look around on the hills surrounding Grant County or wherever it is you're watching from. And there would be the hosts of heaven saying, "I got you. I got this." He's there, whether we can see him or not. But you know, we are in a time where people are afraid. A lot of people are afraid. Fear flourishes in godless environments. And that's where we find ourselves right now. We find ourselves with a lot of fear, and a lot of that is because we're just not looking to God as the author and finisher of our faith. We're not looking to God as our deliverer and strength. Godless environments develop in spiritual darkness. In the book Deep Down in the Dark, written by Hector Tabar, he tells a story of 33 Chilean miners that were trapped underground when the mine collapsed. This happened back in 2010, maybe you remember it. They were in a large space, and they didn't know if they were ever going to get out again. They didn't have any idea whether anybody was coming for them. They weren't sure what to do. And on August 5th, a Christian man named Don Jose Henrique turned to his fellow miner, Marco, and he whispered, "God is the only way we're going to get out of this." And then he looked at him, and he looked at his fellow miners, and in front of all of his fellow miners, he said, "Don Jose, we know you're a Christian man, and we need you to lead us in prayer. Will you do that?" Hector Tabor explains what happened next, and I just want to read that to you because it's so incredible. It says, "From the moment forward, Enrique became known as the pastor to his fellow miners because as soon as he opens his mouth and begins to talk, it's clear he knows how to speak to God. Enrique drops to his knees and he tells the men they should also do so. He said, because when you pray, you have to humble yourself before the Creator. We aren't the best of men, but Lord, have pity on us," Enrique began. It was a simple statement, but it struck into the hearts of the men and it hit them hard. We aren't the best of men. And then he did something I would never have the courage to do. He said, Victor Civega knows he drinks too much. Victor Zamora is too quick to anger. Pedro Cortez thinks about the poor father he's been to his young daughter. He left the girl's mother, and he hasn't even done the basic fatherly things of visiting his little girl, even though he knows his absence is inflicting lasting hurt on her. Then he says, Jesus Christ our Lord, let us enter the sacred throne of your grace. Consider this moment of difficulty of ours. We are sinners and we need you. Just about everyone who is at the entrance of the refuge or inside is on his knees. And then Enrique, as a man of God, and suddenly there in that tomb, found something that he really needed. And at that moment, something came over these men. And as they prayed together, they said after they were rescued, they said as they prayed together, somehow all the fear just began to be wiped away. And all the things that had frightened them, all the things that had scared them, even the fear of death just kind of went away because they knew they had placed themselves in God's hands and they knew they were trusting God in that moment. You see, fear operates in a godless environment. But when we bring God into the picture, that fear gets driven away. Now, I want to say something. Spiritual darkness can even exist in religious circles. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 5, and when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the street, that they may be seen of men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. Their prayer wasn't a meaningful prayer. It wasn't rooted in faith. It wasn't rooted in trusting God. It was a prayer that was self-centered, saying, Lord, I want people, he wasn't even talking to God, saying, just doing it so they could get people to give them their attention and look up to them and think they were somehow better than they are. And you know, sometimes, you know, this may be a blessing right now, because sometimes when people come to church, they do so to put on a show. They want people to see them acting all religious, and then they go home and they scream at the kids and they hit their wives and they kick the dog and they do all sorts of terrible things. They do things and say things that are not godly. But right now, right here, there's no way you can put on a front. I want you to understand that right now, each one of us stand completely exposed before God. It's not about people looking around and seeing whether you're in church right now. Now listen, I'm not saying that coming to church is a bad thing. I believe in church, and I hope when this virus is over that our churches all fill back up to overflowing, because God will deserve the praise. And it'll be a time of fellowship, and it'll be a time of rejoicing. It'll be wonderful. But right now, as we meet in this format, I want to tell you that this is a time to take stock and ask yourself the question, am I allowing spiritual darkness in my religious life? You know, that's why we really should never seek religion. We should seek a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. That's what's most important. I also want you to understand that environments are only godly if we are only godless if we allow them to be. We're called to walk in the light of God's truth. That means we have to address the darkness we may have in our lives that's keeping us from pleasing God, that's standing between us and God. We have to address that. We have to be honest about it. The Bible says in 1 John 1, verses 7 to 9, but if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Darkness flourishes in an environment of sin, and a relationship with God flourishes when we are looking towards that relationship. That light flourishes when we're in that relationship with God and strengthening that relationship. There are a couple of kinds of sins we have to address in our life, though, and we almost always just address one type. There are two types of sins. There's the sins of commission. Those are sins that we know we're not supposed to do, but we do anyway. Sins like lying, stealing, cheating, backbiting, gossiping, self-centeredness, hurting one another, and so on and so forth. Things that we know God's Word says, I don't want you to do that, but we do it anyhow. And we're aware of those sins. Those aren't accidents. 90% of the time, 99% of the time, when we sin like that, we've made the choice to do it. We knew we shouldn't, and we made the choice to do it anyhow. But there are also sins of omission. These are sins that we know God would like us. This is when we know God would like us to do something. God wants us to do something, but we choose not to do it. We omit it from our lives. These are things like spending time in His Word, helping your neighbor, praying for others, praying for leaders. My goodness, right now, if there was ever a time in our country's history where we should be praying for the leaders of our country, for the leaders of our state, for the leaders of our local government and local agencies, right now is the time we should be praying more than ever. But these sins of omission oftentimes show themselves and make up who we are. Both are sin. Both allow darkness to come into our life. And when darkness comes into our life and the light is not there, it's very easy for fear to become a part of who we are. And there's a lot to be afraid of right now. People are afraid of losing their jobs. People are afraid of their businesses going under. People are afraid of getting sick. People are afraid of their families being hurt by the lack of income. People are afraid of family members getting sick. People are wondering. There's, you know, so many questions that are unanswered. We're wondering, how long is this going to go on? How long is it going to continue? There's a lot of fear. And I understand that fear. I understand why it's there. But more than ever, because of that, we need the light of God to shine in our lives. We need it to be shining out of our lives to the people around us. God's people can change the environment that they're in by looking beyond the crisis and looking to the light. Psalms 27:1, David said, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Whom shall I be afraid?" As I go through my day talking with people on the phone and online and through texts and other things, I keep hearing the same thing over and over and over again. I've never seen anything like this, and I've never seen anything like this. They're talking about the response to the coronavirus. There's fear in their comments. There's fear in the tone of their voice. There's fear in the things that they're saying to one another. Fear for their jobs and so on. The ones that don't express fear are able to do so for, I think, two reasons. Either number one, they have a strong faith and know that God is still on the throne, and they're doing everything that God has asked them to do. They're doing everything that the leaders are asking them to do, because they recognize and understand that God has raised up leaders in our midst to lead us during times of crisis. And so instead of ignoring what our leaders are telling us, wash your hands, stay in, 6 feet, the whole business, people are saying, okay, God raised these people up and put them in place. I'm going to listen to what they have to say. They're also trusting that God is going to protect them and be with them through this. Or there are people that are in the second group. They think it's all a hoax. They think our leaders don't know what they're talking about, that it's all a big overreaction, that they're strong enough to overcome any virus that might come, even if not even thinking about the fact that they might pass it on to somebody else who might be seriously hurt by it. I pray you're not that second type. I pray that doesn't define you. We need to look to the Word of God and see how God works in our lives to direct us and guide us through His Word and through the lives of those that He has placed in leadership over us. There's a verse in Psalm 119, verse 130. I love the verse. It says, "The unfolding of your word gives light." Wow. Let me read that again. The unfolding of your word, as we open up the Word of God and allow it to permeate our lives, it says, "The unfolding of your word gives light." It gives understanding to the simple. And let's be honest, we're all simple in God's eyes. I read a story of a father who wanted to teach his son how to swim. It was a great story. And in this story, the son is 1 year old. And he's got this little swimmy diaper on him, and he's wanting to take him out into the water, and he's wanting to teach him how to swim. But the little boy's afraid. He's afraid of the water. And so his dad carries him, takes him down the water, and after time, he finally gets where the little boy will kind of like blow bubbles with his mouth while he holds him and all that kind of stuff. And he thinks he's getting him ready for the next step. So he sets him up on the side of the pool, and he says, "Okay, son, jump. Daddy will catch you." And the little boy looks at him and gets a range of emotions on his face and finally says, "I go mommy," and turns around and walks away. And he won't jump. He's too afraid. So dad gets out of the pool and runs over and catches him. And after a lot of pleading and bribing and everything else, he finally brings him back to the side of the pool and gets down in the pool. Dad gets down in the pool and he says, "Okay, son, I'm here. I'll catch you. Jump." And the little boy, he kind of, you know, starts a couple times to jump, but he kind of makes that little motion, and he's standing there trying to work up the courage, and finally he jumps, and dad catches him. And the minute dad catches him, the little boy is ecstatic. He's excited. He said, "Do it again, Daddy, do it again." And so he goes back up, and he jumps again for a half an hour. That dad had to stand there while that little boy ran up there and jumped in the pool, ran up there and jumped in the pool, and dad caught him each time. Later on, the father and the mother were talking about it and said, "You know, maybe we got him too familiar with the pool. Maybe he's too unafraid of the pool. We've got to watch, because maybe he goes out there and he thinks, you know, I've got this down now. I've jumped. I'm not afraid of the water anymore. And that could be dangerous." And so they were watching him, and they realized that he still had a real fear of the water, a real respect for the water. He wouldn't go near the edge of the water unless dad was in the pool. They understood that he was not trusting, the little boy was not trusting in his own abilities. He was trusting in his father. I want to tell you, we have a Heavenly Father that's saying, "Don't worry, you can jump, I'll catch you." In conclusion, you know, the Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God, and the peace of God," that thing that everybody's looking for, "the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." This morning, God is saying to you, don't be afraid. Look past the coronavirus. See that God is still on the throne. Understand that God is in control. Look to Him for your strength. Look to Him for your help. Look to Him for your guidance. And if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, if you've never come to that place where you've asked Jesus to be your Savior, right now, in your home, where you're at, whatever you're watching on, you can pray a simple prayer that says, "Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Forgive me for my sin. I accept what Jesus did on the cross in payment for my sin, and I want to receive Him as my Savior today." If you can pray a simple prayer like that, God will receive you. We have a Heavenly Father that promises to catch us. He can catch us if we fall in fear during a crisis. We have to look past the water. We have to look past the crisis. We have to look past the coronavirus and see our Heavenly Daddy standing there, ready to catch us, and have faith that He will. I want to share another song with you that just nails this idea. It's called "At the Foot of the Cross." And I want to share that with you at this time. I hope it's a blessing to you. I hope you receive encouragement from it as our closing song. Then we'll come back and I'll lead in a closing prayer. So please listen as we share this song with you.
The foot of the cross, where grace and suffering meet, received, and you've won my heart. Yes, you've won my heart. Now I can trade these ashes in for beauty, and wear forgiveness like a coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross, at the foot of the cross. Ashes in for beauty, and wear forgiveness like a crown, coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross. I trade these ashes in for beauty. Like a crown, coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross. Ashes in for beauty, and wear forgiveness like a crown, coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross. I trade these ashes in for beauty. Like a crown, coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down. I lay every burden down. I lay every
I hope that is a encouragement to you. If you're going through a burden today that maybe has nothing to do with the coronavirus, but or work or anything like that, but you're struggling, maybe you're struggling with cancer, or you're struggling with some other illness, or maybe you're struggling in your relationship with your husband or wife, or whatever it is that you might be struggling with, I want to close in a word of prayer, and I want to pray for you. And I just want to say that God is still there, and don't be afraid. Allow him, just lean on him, lean into him, place your faith in him, trust in him, and he'll bring you through. Let's close in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for this moment. I thank you for this time that we've been able to share together in your presence from our homes, from our wherever we're watching from. Father, I just thank you for the privilege of being able to share like this. And I thank you, Father, that you've allowed us this opportunity, this medium to glorify you. Father, I just pray that you receive all the glory. And Lord, I just pray for, again, I pray against this coronavirus. Lord, I ask that you very quickly just allow it to pass through this country. In fact, Father, if it would just stop today, we would all go to the streets praising your name. But Father, I also want to pray for those that are watching that are struggling with fear, that are struggling with other problems, that are struggling with other difficulties. Father, I pray that you'll be with them today. I pray, Lord, that you'll just wrap them in your arms of love. I pray, Father, that they will place their trust in you, that they will lean into your word, that they will lean into personal times of prayer, that they can grow stronger in their relationship with you, and that that light that will come into their life as a result of that time spent with you will banish the darkness and fear that exists in their lives. Father, thank you for the time that we've shared here today. I pray that you're honored by it. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to know that we're going to be doing this again next Sunday. And in fact, we're going to be streaming our services from now on, but maybe I won't be quite as close to the camera. I'll be up there at the pulpit, so you won't get to see my good-looking face quite as well. But anyhow, you're welcome to join us anytime. But even more than that, we'd love to have you to once the services start again, we would love to have you join us in church. You have a great day. God bless you. We will see you next Sunday.
out to him.